The scenario is Dine and Dash from the Caribbean Sea battle set, written for Harpoon 3 and the player's database. With the game on pause, we'll reposition the map windows in order to maximize the efficiency of the game user interface. We'll examine the scenario, background, and information. And our current orders. Our mission is to approach the safe house and try to evacuate the political refugees. But first we must find their location, and to do so we will have to fly helicopters in to locate them. The exact location is not known, but it appears as though the TACB has a 1 mile range, which is similar to the range of the magnetic anomaly detection gear aboard the helicopters. So we'll find the location as long as we get our helicopters within about a mile of their location. And we know that it's near Puerto La Cruz, but we don't know exactly where. The important thing is all Venezuelan units may be engaged. So as long as we can positively identify them as Venezuelan, we are cleared to fire. Now we'll examine our assets. We are in command of the guided missile destroyer Roosevelt, as well as units at the Munoz Air National Guard Base. Aboard the destroyer, we have two Strike Hawks configured with air-to-ground Hellfire missiles. At the airbase, we have a compass call for electronic warfare, which will launch immediately, as well as an Orion for anti-surface strikes. These are AGM-84Ks, which are capable against anti-ship or anti-surface units. And we have 5 Strike Eagles for anti-air warfare. We'll launch a pair of them for combat air patrol above the destroyer. And we'll begin the scenario. And we'll pause. And we can see that our destination in general is Puerto La Cruz. We're going to plot a course for it. And we will engage our sonar on intermittent active. It's known that Venezuela does operate diesel-electric submarines. By intermittently turning the sonar on and off, we hope that any submarines that might detect us will not have sufficient information to develop a track on us. However, by turning them on and off, we can hope to also detect any very quiet diesel-electric submarines, which passive sonar normally would not. And we'll continue. Our aircraft are up, and we will immediately send them towards the destroyer in hopes of getting a better picture on a grasp on the situation. We'll order the compass call to maximum altitude and to hover or circle the destroyer, providing electronic warfare jamming. In this way, we don't have to turn on the destroyer's jammers and possibly revealing her location. The name of the game is staying hidden. Hopefully, if with a little luck, we can slip in, grab the evacuees or the refugees, as you might want to describe them, and be out before the enemy knows we've even been here. Several contacts are noted, and we can see them on both east and west of our ship. We'll check and we'll note their air search radar, and this type of air search radar is found on a number of ships. However, it's unlikely that there are any Italian vessels in this part of the world, and it's unlikely that they're Ecuadorian or Libyan or Peruvian vessels at this point. So most likely it is this Mariscal Sucre guided missile frigate from the Venezuelan Navy. And we will classify her hostile immediately and rename it Sucre. There's a second one, also same type, so we know it is probably the same class of vessel. Now the Sucre is a formidable opponent. She carries surface-to-air missiles, Albatross, which fires the Aspide, has a range of respectable range of 8.5 miles. This is further greater than the air-to-ground missile range of the Hellfires carried aboard our Strike Hawks, which is only about 5 miles. So any helicopter approaching with Hellfires is likely going to be shot down by the Sucre. As well, she carries a formidable 127mm gun with a range of 11.8 nautical miles. But her main teeth are her 8 automat missiles. The minimum range for these are 55 miles, and they could have been upgraded, but we'll go with the assumption that they're using the 100-mile range Mark III's. Now, to the west, we see the same type of search radar, so we can classify these as most likely the same class of vessels. A second radar. Now, this is a little bit more information, but once again, we know they can't be Italian vessels, nor can they be Peruvian, or so the only possible choice left is a Venezuelan vessel. Again, the Sucre class. Now, number of aircraft have been detected from over the mainland bases, and we can classify these as Mirage fighters, and they're coming from right over Venezuela, so it's most likely a Mirage fighter, and we'll classify them hostile. Other contacts are detected, and we can see that these are tracker type radar, maritime patrol or anti-submarine warfare. Now these are probably some of our more dangerous opponents at this time, because they have air to surface search radar, and they're the ones that can actually locate us. So we'll keep an eye on these maritime patrol aircraft. And here's another one, and this is a more avioguard. This is more maritime patrol than anti-submarine, but we will still have to be respectful of these platforms. And another Mirage. And we'll add a little time compression, get our planes into the region. Now hopefully my strategy will be to keep the enemy as blind as long as possible. If he can't see me, he can't hit me. But these four frigates are very dangerous, as they carry a total of 32 missiles. Now that's a lot of firepower. They're subsonic missiles, the automats, but they still can deliver a fairly heavy punch should one of them land. 42 points damage for either one, and they're somewhat accurate, 80% and 85%. But the real problem is they will drain our surface-to-air missile batteries. Now we have plenty of reloads over in the Munoz, so we have lots of possible missiles. We have close to 300 missiles for use, but we only have 5 fighters with which to deliver them, so only so many can be on station at a time. Now we've got more radar contacts in the south, and we can classify these. It doesn't look like there's going to be any Royal Navy ships nor Indian ships, so this one is the only possible ship is going to be the Almirante Clemente, most likely. So we're going to classify, and her main weapon is her guns, which have a maximum range of 4 kilometers. So we'll classify her hostile and rename it the Frigate Escort Clemente. Now, the anti-surface weaponry aboard the Roosevelt, our maximum range is our missiles, but we don't have many, and most of our are from our guns, which have a range of 9.1. So in a confrontation with the Clemente, in a gun battle, the Roosevelt will win. However, in a gun battle against Sucre-class guided missile frigates, it's most likely that the Roosevelt would be on the losing end, since the range of her guns are shorter than the range of the Venezuelan guns. Now, I'm going to be using the Strike Eagles in a reconnaissance role. We're going to turn on one of their radar, simply because a Strike Eagle is more capable of surviving any hostile encounter with a Venezuelan unit because of their high speed and maneuverability. Instead of using I won't be turning on the Orion just yet, because she's still a maritime asset and she is unable to defend herself. So until we can at least win a little bit of air superiority or air supremacy over the Roosevelt, we're going to be playing it somewhat more cautiously. And more air radar contacts are detected. Now we can classify these more Mirage fighters and more. Now the Mirage fighters are not as dangerous as the flankers are, because the fighters have approximate weapon range of 4 Now these are only have a range of approximately 10 miles or 4 miles for their heat-seeking missiles, and the supers are the radar guided missiles. Now the range of an AMRAAM C-7 is 75 miles, so we can take our time. We're not very threatened by the Venezuelan Mirage. And more search aircraft. Now another surface contact has materialized, and we can see this is fire control radar, so this is a military vessel. Once again we check, and we can see that the only real potential military vessel is either the Sucre class, or it could be one of these patrol cutters, the Constitucion or Federacion class for Venezuela. Now the Federacion class are more dangerous, as they carry more of these automat missiles, and whereas the Federacion class are mostly just gunboats, but they still have a respectable gun range of approximately 4 miles. So we can tell that these are, and there are no other possible vessels this could be. So even though we know it cannot be an Italian vessel or a Peruvian vessel or a Canadian vessel, we still don't know exactly which of the three Venezuelan classes it could be. However, it is sufficient information for us to classify them hostile, and we'll worry about their exact name as we get closer and hopefully run a little bit better reconnaissance on them. And we'll increase time compression. And more fighters have been detected in the air. And additional ships, more of the same category. Once again, same radar. So we know it must be a Venezuelan ship, but not exactly which of the three classes. So we'll classify her hostile. And another one with the same fire control radar. And again. my plan will be to engage and hopefully destroy one of these Sucre class. We have aboard the Orion, we have two slammer missiles, and we also have another Orion will be ready in approximately 24 minutes. By combining the two fight planes, we will have four slammers, and with a little luck, this should be enough to destroy at least one of the guided missile frigates. So we're going to pit our four missiles against her eight. If that would be a good return on investment if we could sink her. Now, here are some flankers. Now, these have got to be the Venezuelans, and no one else is. The Chinese and the Indians aren't in the area. Now, flankers are dangerous components, as they can be carrying four different kinds of Alamo. If they happen to have the long-range surface semi-active radar homing, they could fire from a range of 75 miles, and that's greater than our AMRAAM range, theoretically. And they can also fire Alamo infrared missiles, which have a range of 74 miles. Again, just about the same as ours. These are fire and forget and require no radar guidance. So we're going up against flankers. We're going to be calling for reinforcements, and that means we're going to launch our two relief Eagles right away. Now we have our flankers on radar, and we'll classify them hostile and rename them flank because we know they have to be that type of fighter. We'll move towards them as we are already cleared to engage. That is one less thing we have to worry about. And we'll redirect our attack towards one of the Sucre classes. Our relief flights are on the way, and we will move our Eagles on station to intercept. As they close, a number of additional surface contacts can be detected. However, they're not radiating any radar signature, so we are unable to classify them at this time. However, we will concentrate on the enemy flankers, as they are the most dangerous opponents in the Venezuelan Air Force. We'll move in at maximum full military power in order to engage from maximum range. By matching this or having greater speed than the targets, we can engage at longer range than normal, or at maximum range. Otherwise, the AI will require that we close the distance and in order to fire a no escape envelope. Now, we're turning and we're going to run the other direction in order to evade any missiles that the target may have fired in our direction. Remember, the target can carry Alamo long-range missiles that are just as long-ranged as our weapons, plus they don't need any guidance. Now, the reason why we can pull a loop and turn away is because our AMRAAMs are true fire-and-forget missiles. They do not require radar guidance from the firing platform. And so this is not a game exploit, this is just being cautious. So our missiles are on the way, and we are evading any potential counterfire. And a hit! With the first hit, now we will turn back towards the target. There are still other Mirage and flanker fighters. Oh, and here come the two counterfires. So we will evade once again on afterburner. And now that we've successfully evaded, we will climb back to altitude. The automatic evasion program, and it's still coming in, so we will go back to reheat. There we go. And the missile has been successfully evaded. The AI will automatically order our planes to dive and accelerate to afterburner in order to evade missiles. Now, with the incredible fuel range of the Strike Eagles, they carry conformal tanks, which allows them to pretty much run from across an entire ocean. And the Mirage has come in very closely, and we'll have to dispatch her with one AMRAP. Although the Mirage has a missile, it's really not very dangerous unless it's within approximately 10 miles. So the incredible range of the Strike Eagle and the C-7 AMRAAM means that we can fire, evaluate, and then fire again. Normally, the AI would fire two missiles before at every target and then evaluate. And while this is what the doctrine allows for, I find it tends to waste missiles on the less threatening targets. Now, with flankers, that's a different story. However, the Mirage are not very capable fighters, so we can afford to fire, evaluate, and then fire again. Since we've already been intercepted once, and they know our position, we will activate our radar. Here comes a second Mirage, and she's got lots of room between her and us. She's coming in at 750 knots, but we should have enough time to fire and evaluate the results. And another kill. Here comes the flanker that we are more concerned about, and we'll go to full military power in order to close on her. Behind her is another flanker. We must give these aircraft great respect, and we'll see two of them, and we'll fire a volley of two. We'll see if we can get the last one. Nope, too far. So we'll turn and we will engage our afterburners in to evade any potential counterfire. And a miss. Incredible. Good job on the flankers for evasion. And he's got a pair off at us. See? That's the counterfire we were worried about. Now, we're already evading, and they're too far away, so we can't return fire on them. This is not an exploit, remember, because our AMRAAM do not require radar guidance from the firing platform. So, and we'll increase speed from our other flanker. We want to take these flankers want to be killed very, very badly. But he's already used up his two long-range missiles, and now it's our turn. Now, his other long-range missiles are medium or more medium range than anything else, so we're not going to worry too much about them because they're 50 mile range, and we'll get a chance to re-engage should these two miss. And a hit. Now you have two more, and I will go back to full speed. On the way home, we are going to try and shoot down this helicopter or surveillance aircraft. We only have guns, but this is an unarmed maritime patrol aircraft, so we should not have a problem if we can get into range. We can. Oh, there comes the counterfire right there. And even we're going to evade on afterburner. And a second aircraft, more Mirage fighters. Notice how the missile is still tracking us. This must be an infrared homing missile in order for it to try and follow our evasive maneuvers. As the launching aircraft has already... There it is. It's been fully identified as Alamo D infrared. Now we've lost contact of it, so it's probably been missed us, or else we decoyed by one of the chaff or flares that we've employed. Now these maritime aircraft are still more dangerous as they are Venezuelan, and we know that they can report the position of our ship. So we're going to try to make a quick fly past and maybe shoot them down with guns before we head back to base and rearm. We don't want to waste valuable AMRAAM missiles on them because they're not unarmed targets in the first place. And here comes a second Mirage. We'll try to take her out with a single AMRAAM. Oh, and as we get closer, we can more fully identify and confirm the contacts. Now, we know this one can't be... Okay, they've clarified, so we now know it's either Constitution or Federation class patrol cutter. And this one's definitely Federation, so we can rename it. Now, the Federation are the gun-only patrol cutters, so they have less range, and they're about 4 miles. There's a second vessel beside her, and most likely this is going to be a Constitution class, because we were able to classify this one as Federation by her missions, yet we aren't able to classify this one as Federation, so I'm going to assume that this one's going to be a Constitution class, simply because with the same signature, we were able to classify one but not the other. So, and we've overflown another patrol gunboat, which only has guns on it. So we're going to approach this one, and we're going to conduct a strafing run over it. Perhaps we can... Oh, and the Mirage is down. The Strike Eagle. We can dive down, and hopefully a few rounds of 20 millimeter will be sufficient to destroy this gunboat. As we unload our guns into it. And hit, and she appears to be dead in the water and sinking. Now back up to altitude. We'll continue to close. Another flanker, and we've only got one missile left. Bad situation, and we're caught low and slow. Not a place your fighter pilots want to be. So we'll classify flanker, and we'll pause the game, and we'll try to bring in some help, which appears in the form of our two relief eagles. Maybe we'll get our last missile off and then have to run for home. And there we go. As we have no other missiles and no weapons available, we will run for home on afterburner. With our incredible fuel reserves, we can do this, and by spending more time running on afterburner to and from the base, we spend less time in transit. That means we have still the same ready time, reload time, but if we can keep our planes on station longer rather than running back at cruise speed, we hopefully will have more cycles whereby we will be in... There we go, and the flanker is down. We'll have more cycles so that we can be on station. And there's the Venezuelan patrol aircraft, and we've just blasted her out of the air with guns. Good job. No kill like a gun kill. And now we'll head back on afterburner. We'll be heading back on afterburner. We know that we'll be fairly safe because if the aircraft runs low on fuel, the AI will immediately drop it back down to cruise speed anyway. And as we head back, we can classify the enemy on the side. We now know it's got to be Sucre because it can't be the other two. So our previous classification still holds, and we aren't right. As our Orions seem to have won aerial superiority over a small area, at least of the battlefield, we can now activate the radar on our Orion in greater safety. Now we've detected another airborne contact. This is most likely a helicopter from Venezuela. Now their sensors are approximately 60-mile range. Maximum range. So we'll keep an eye on her and see. Her range is currently approximately 100. So she's still out of range, and so our destroyer is fairly safe. We're going to try, however, because of her position, she lies between us and the target. Meaning that if we fire on the target, she might be able to provide airborne early warning of our missiles. And that will give the target more time to react and possibly fire and shoot down our missiles. So we're going to bring one of our Eagles in and see if we can't shoot down this annoying helicopter. At the same time, we are well within range of the target, so we want to combine the missile fire from both of our aircraft so that it arrives at the same time, and hopefully we can overwhelm the frigate's defenses. So we're going to order our planes to rendezvous. So that they might better coordinate their attack. And more enemy air contacts have been detected. Several more contacts have been detected, and we're going to engage them as their mirage will take our time and allocate our missiles sparsely. And the older fighters are shot down easily. We're also able to fully classify the remaining surface contacts. With local air superiority, we're now going to try and shoot down this pesky helicopter with guns instead of one of our valuable AMRAAM missiles. Her range is approximately 80 miles from the destroyer, so we still have plenty of range. As well, our compass call is most likely degrading her radar, so she is most likely unable to even detect our destroyer at this time. And we are almost in range for guns. And we go guns. And it's down. We'll stay on station in case any other helicopters are launched and wait for the Orions to make their attack. As we see the range ring, here's the inbound Orion and the Orion that is off station. And more enemy contacts are detected. More Mirage. We'll move to claim this easy victory, hopefully. As we can see, our two range rings are now combining, and we are ready to fire. Combine them, and we will attack the most common aircraft. Now, these are fire-and-forget missiles, so there is no need for us to hang around. We'll run back to base and rearm and refuel as fast as we can. Meanwhile, we'll try to claim this last bogey and keep the enemy blind. Oh, and another one behind him. So we'll fire one and take a look at the second one is also Mirage. Now we have a number of bogeys that are unclassified, so we're going to fly in and take this opportunity to identify them. Oh, and a miss. So we will re-engage both Mirage with a single AMRAAM and head for home to rearm and refuel. Our missiles are approaching the target, and we've identified a second gunboat. We'll also try a strafing attack on her in order to save the missiles, as we have very few offensive weapons. Oh, and our surviving Mirage will earn herself a single AMRAAM missile. Oh, out of range. I guess it never fired. And it's hostile. And hopefully a single gun pass. Oh, and it is quite sufficient to destroy the little gunboat. And we'll continue with our reconnaissance. And climb back up to altitude for higher speed and maneuverability. As the slammers are just about to arrive on their target. And a kill for the Mirage. Another claim. And the Sucre still has not taken defensive action yet. And he is hit by two slammers, sinking. So 8 enemy missiles are now out of action. Several more air contacts have been detected, and they are flankers. So we'll be calling up more reinforcements and moving to engage. We may have been lucky first couple of times, but our luck can only hold out for so long. The enemy can have some luck too, and he's managed to be able to manage to fire a few Alamo back in our direction. And here they come. Both are off the racks, and we move into a loop immediately. And another flanker down. And there comes that missile. Still tracking, so we managed to pick her up and are just barely visual range, and they're down. Okay. So we'll turn back to engage the second flanker. Looks like she's interested in the Southern Eagle, and we'll make it worth her while. We'll increase to max full speed. And send a pair of C-7s after her for her curiosity. As well, we've note a Surface SA-15, this must be the SA-15 battery that was detected and evaded by our refugees. So we have another point of reference. And we launch and run. And a kill. But even as we report the victory, more missiles inbound. As well as another flanker in the air. How many did Uncle Hugo buy? And we should have successfully evaded now. And we'll climb back up to altitude. But the second flank, the last flanker, is streaking in on full military power. Thereby forcing us to... Oh! She's got one off on us! Okay, we're going to fire... We want her very badly dead. So we'll fire an extra AMRAAM at her. run for safety. And she survived. Excellent maneuvering. Testament to the ability of Sukhoi to build capable fighters. However, our eagle is out of missiles and is simply trying to evade the return fire. And a submarine contact has been detected. She's moving at 4 knots. Now, it's virtually impossible to classify a submarine contact by nationality. However, no other country in the region operates submarines except for Venezuela and Colombia. Now, unlike our Colombian allies are unlikely to have a submarine in the disputed area, so we're going to treat it as hostile. We'll try to engage from maximum range. We have a rocket launched, aerial anti-submarine rocket, an ASROC. This will launch a rocket into the area, towards the target, which will then try to deploy an anti-submarine warfare torpedo. Now, we have plenty of time. If it's a diesel-electric submarine, which is all that Venezuela has, it can only move at a maximum of approximately 15 knots at flank speed. So we are able to simply avoid them rather than running over them. And it won't take us too far out of its path. We're going to mark this one as a potential submarine position, and if we don't sink it on as we pass, we will come back to it, but we're not going to rearm any of our helicopters to deal with it, since it is not an immediate threat we can easily avoid. And another flanker has been detected as we move in. The odds are not good. We have one eagle versus two flankers, but with AMRAAM C7, the odds are a little bit more even. And the torpedo, or the ASROC, has landed, but we don't know if the ASROC has successfully deployed its torpedo, as we do not hear anything on the sonar. Could have been a dud, could have broken up upon impact. And we only have 4 C7s, so we'll have a pair for each eagle, each flanker, if that's the case. And we will turn to evade. And success. Here comes that second flanker. A torpedo is detected in the water, but we don't know if that's the enemy firing one at us or that's our anti-submarine torpedo chasing after him. and we cannot ignore a torpedo in the water, so we're going to flank speed to evade. Meanwhile, our Eagle has managed to get in range and launch her final two AMRAAM at the flanker. Now we're going to turn and run for home. And a flanker is down. As we can tell from the speed of the torpedo, it looks like it's a 52 knot torpedo. This is the same speed of our M Mark 46 anti-submarine torpedo. So this is most likely the anti-submarine torpedo and not an inbound torpedo on the destroyer. So we'll slow back down to cruise speed and reduce our acoustic signature. It appears as though the torpedo is having a difficult time localizing or hitting the target. So we're going to rearm one of our Strike Hawks for anti-submarine warfare with Barracuda torpedoes, and she'll be ready in 30 minutes. We're going to launch the second Strike Hawk, and we're going to send it after the missile corvettes. With a little luck, they'll be able to sink these corvettes that carry the automat missiles, thereby taking them out of play. Meanwhile, some reconnaissance aircraft, the Aviocar, have a range of approximately 100 miles on their radar. And we'll check the range. We're only 75 miles off, so he's getting pretty close to detection threshold, and so we're going to have to pop this guy. Now, we'll also send our Strike Hawk in low towards the missile-armed corvettes. Once again, we'll try to close the distance to the target and bring her down with guns as opposed to valuable missiles. And she's in gun range. And fires off her 20mm cannon. And a kill. Before she turns back to engage the S2 tracker. However, she will have to come into gun range of the corvettes, but they are more of a nuisance than actual threat. And a gun pass on the second recon plane. Blast it right out of the air. With local air superiority guaranteed, we're going to classify and identify the remaining surface contacts in case any of them happen to be associated with Venezuela. As well, we intend to shoot down any this last helicopters and aircraft or air reconnaissance aircraft. Another gun pass. For another victory. However, an additional S-2 has already been detected launching from the airbase, so we'll move to take her under fire. Three additional aircraft are easily detected and classified as they climb to altitude. With air superiority virtually guaranteed, we are going to fire some of our valuable AMRAAM missiles. Oh, and another fast mover is in the air. It can't be reconnaissance. It's moving at 500 knots. So, and most likely another Mirage fighter. And two of them. Moving at 750 knots. Definitely a fighter. We're classifying them hostile and engaging. And the three recon aircraft are down. And the Mirage evades. At least they're not flankers. And a second evasion. Good job. However, all the more pleasure to kill him. And the third missile does the trick. As our Eagles cycle back towards base for rearming and refueling, our Strike Hawk has now come ready and will launch to try and prosecute this submarine. As well, our Strike Hawk armed with Hellfire are moving in to range on the missile corvettes. And more bogies are detected rising from El Libertador. Although there is no radar detected, these are most likely Mirage fighters, according to their speed. They've moved to military speed and we'll match them. And send off a volley of AMRAAM. And one for the recon plane, just for good measure. A second recon plane is detected in the distance, and we'll try to claim her as well. send one more, and our strike hawk has come into range and confirmed the position of the submarine with her active sonar. The submarine appears to be still chasing after the Roosevelt, and so we will prosecute her. Meanwhile, the second strike hawk is now closing on almost within range of the Federation. And the recon plane is destroyed. We'll send him home with, even though there's one missile left, we'll send it home as we have another Eagle already on station to provide coverage. The Strike Hawk is now in range and will unleash a pair of Hellfire. Now, the Federation corvettes are very small vessels, only take 9 hits, so a single missile should suffice. However, we're going to make certain by sending an extra Hellfire at them. And one hit, and it is sinking as she moves on to her second target. Meanwhile, over the submarine has been localized and will be attacked by the Strike Hawk. We have 2 Barracuda torpedoes. Now, the game will allow us to launch many, many torpedoes in the water without any problem, any restrictions. However, in real life, submarine contacts are engaged with a single torpedo at any one time for fear that multiple torpedoes will interfere with the sonar of other torpedoes. So, even though the game will allow us to fire many multiple torpedoes at the same target, we're going to engage with one at a time as they would most likely do in real life. It appears as though the first torpedo has missed. We will re-engage. As we are also prosecuting the Constitution. Oh, and a torpedo has hit the Goblin. Explosion in the water. So we know that we have hit it at least once, and it appears to be sinking, breaking up noises. So we can classify that as a positive, definite kill. The second Strike Hawk is also entering range of the Constitution, and she'll go to a hover and send another pair of Hellfire. And another hit, and again it is dead in the water. With 4 additional missiles remaining, she'll head towards a second group of patrol corvettes that also carry automat surface-to-surface missiles, and she will engage. Our second Strike Hawk moves in, and oh, more bogeys have been detected. Oh, just helicopters. But these helicopters can still detect and relay our position. As far as we know, the enemy has not yet been able to detect us or confirm our location. So we are still keeping them blind, and we won't like to keep it that way. So we're going to engage this helicopter and shoot it down as our Strike Hawk moves in on the missile-armed corvettes. We're going to ignore the Victoria for now because she's a Federation class and she only has guns. In a gun duel between her and Roosevelt, Roosevelt would win. So we're going to concentrate on the missile-armed frigates. And it is well within range, so we're going to send a single AMRAAM after her. And it appears as though the helicopter is down. We'll keep the Eagle close by in case anyone tries to interfere with the Strike Hawk, as she's totally defenseless against enemy aircraft. We'll fly a roundabout route to avoid the gun range of the Victoria, and now we will approach. Oh, another bogey's in the air. False contact. And she'll send a pair of Hellfires into the Patria. Now, she could also destroy Victoria, but I think she's going to concentrate on Independencia because it's another Constitucion class Corvette, which carries surface-to-surface missiles. And the Strike Hawk approaches her final victim. And sends two more Hellfires into it. A hit! And the Independencia is destroyed. The situation is looking good, with many missile frigates destroyed. There's one Mariscal Sucre and two more in the west, but the one is moving in our general direction, and we may have to deal with her. However, the other two are seemingly on area patrol. Perhaps we just might be able to pull this off and get in and out before the enemy can localize us. With aerial superiority virtually guaranteed due to the presence of three Strike Eagle interceptors, I'm going to send one more Strike Eagle in at high altitude to try and localize this surface-to-air missile battery. The SA-15 has a maximum engagement range of altitude of 6,500 meters. So if we can stay above that altitude, we should be impervious. A bogey has been detected, another reconnaissance plane, and we'll move to try and bag her. She's quite a distance away, but we never know when she might just decide to change direction and head our way. Oh, and we have managed to localize the SA-15 battalion that's been giving us so much trouble. Although we are safely outside the engagement envelope of the SA-15, it still is able to provide some a modicum of aerial coverage, so we do want this aircraft, we do want this SA-15 to be destroyed as soon as possible. But the only apparent weapons we have against it are our guns. The Roosevelt does have 8 Tomahawk tactical missiles, and we will fire them at the SA-15. However, SA-15 is very capable of defense in her own regard, so it is no guarantee that we will be able to destroy her even with 8 powerful Tomahawk missiles. However, we aren't paid to bring them back either, so we may as well try. Another helicopter has been detected above the Sucre, and we'll see if we can't bring her down. Now that we have a little bit more greater sense of security in our zone, we can use up the longer range missiles. And brought down. And the 8 Tomahawks continue to track on. Oh, and they're hit and the SA-15 is destroyed, sinking. Several more Mirage have been detected. Looks like they're bringing up reserves. Each will be engaged with more AMRAAM. And two more kills. The enemy is persistent and sends up even more Mirage fighters, but they're bounced as soon as they get in the air by a marauding Strike Eagle. But the fighters manage to escape and return to base as soon as the Eagles fire. They survived for another day. Colonel Chavez may not be very happy with their apparent cowardice, but at least their planes are not destroyed. And a second submarine contact is detected, also moving 4 knots. Just about the right speed for a diesel electric. Her range is approximately 11 miles. Must have gotten some bottom bounce. And we'll check out. We'll launch our Strike Hawk and we'll rearm the second helicopter for anti-submarine as well. We can use her to search for the evacuees, and we'll move to evade. We'll mark this one. Oh, and here it comes. Here comes the helicopter, and we'll send her in low with active radar sonar. We'll mark the second position as S sub as well. As a Strike Hawk hovers, oh, there she goes, popping out the side at almost point-blank range. She'll drop one Barracuda in the water, and as well as a sonobuoy to help track the target. With her active sonar pinging away, looks like the first torpedo is total miss. It may be heading off somewhere to the south. She'll fire a second torpedo. And a hit! Breakup noises and wreckage comes to the surface. The Goblin is destroyed. Time to return to base. Meanwhile, the Roosevelt approaches the landing zone, or the pickup point, for Puerto de la Cruz. Unfortunately, the destroyer, or the frigate escort, Trinidad Moran, is situated pretty much directly in her path, and we don't have time in order to evade. So, looks like we're going to have to engage and go through her rather than around her. as well. Our two aircraft, Orion strike aircraft, maritime patrol, I guess, aircraft, are now ready, and we will send them to attack the second Mariscal Sucre. Hopefully, we will be able to sink this one as well, and then after we make our rescue, we intend to make our egress through the eastern side, thereby avoiding the other two Sucre as well as the surviving corvettes. That's the plan, anyway. And my maritime anti-strike Orions are now within range of the final Sucre. Normally, with their close proximity to other neutral vessels, innocent fishermen and whatnot, I would be a little bit less hesitant to engage from maximum range, mainly because we cannot risk an international incident whereby innocent civilians are harmed. However, the slammers are connected to the launching platform by data links, so they have targeting information updates constantly, and this should prevent them from accidentally launching or approaching an enemy, a civilian vessel. The operator can continue to provide guidance all throughout the flight path. We have a number of aircraft launching from Simon Bolivar Air Base. It looks like the enemy has found us. Now, they're calling in the clans on us, and we will do the same. We'll be moving all of our interceptors to protect the destroyer. It appears though it is a massive air raid in progress. They're all launching from the military air base. There are no radar emissions detected. However, ...40 or 50 civilian aircraft just do not take to the air at the same time. So, just by their behavior, we are going to classify them hostile. Here they come. Still no radar emissions yet. And more Mirage fighters are appearing behind them. And we'll engage. We'll allocate one missile per aircraft and let the follow-on fighters engage on their own. Once again, we'll apply our missiles sparingly and run for home. Several hits are reported, but will they be enough? Second flight arrives and launches their 6 AMRAAM. As does the third. there does appear to be just too many targets for us to destroy. As well, if they have radiated our, or announced our position of the destroyer, it means that the Sucre and other missile corvettes are trying to close on our location. Not a good thing. All of our missiles are expended and still they're approaching. Fearless. Soon, the destroyer will have to rely upon her own defenses. And here they come. With no other combat air patrols able to intercept, the destroyer activates her own radar and jammers. She'll allocate one missile per plane, as she has the range in which to and time in which to do this. Her first wave of SAMs is in the air. Success. However, enough survivors require a second engagement. And vampires are detected. Vampire, vampire, vampire. Looks like these are the Mirage armed with Exocet missiles, and they've managed to successfully launch their birds. So now we have many more targets to engage. The second salvo of surface-to-air missiles is airborne. Many targets are hit, but will it be enough? And a third salvo is required. The third salvo is in the air, nearly exhausting the entire missile magazine of the Roosevelt. Apparently, the enemy has been able to mix up Falcon, F-16 Falcon bombers, as well as Freedom Fighters, in amongst their Mirage, which means they have been able to draw some of our missile fire away from the other Strikers. Well done. And we are almost out of standard missiles. However, the Venezuelans have accomplished a great feat. They have managed to exhaust most of our surface-to-air missiles. And the last two Falcons will be engaged with evolved Sea Sparrows instead of the longer-ranged standard missiles. However, a second group is already approaching, and there are very few missiles left to engage. The first wave appears to have been defeated, but just barely. And it is now within gun range, the last Falcon, before she's destroyed. In the east, our four slammers are approaching the Sucre. Perhaps they will kill her before she has a chance to release her missiles. And one's hit. And the Sucre, it appears as though the radar is down, but we have no confirmed. The sensors report two slammers have hit the target. Whether or not that is sufficient to destroy them is unknown. And here comes the second wave. Roosevelt has almost no surface-to-air missiles remaining, and her final looks like there's at least 15 to 20 more strikers. Now she has her gun batteries and her evolved Sea Sparrow missiles as defenses only. And the enemy is launching. Vampire, vampire, vampire. More exosets are inbound. We are too late with our SAMs. They still managed to score a few kills, though. However, it may very well be moot if the destroyer does not survive. And as they come into range, the Roosevelt will engage, once again using only one Sea Sparrow per target. Roosevelt fights hard and sends her Sea Sparrows up. Hits. Will they be enough? Will there be enough missiles left? Six missiles survive the blast and are re-engaged. And success! However, Roosevelt missile batteries are totally depleted, with only 9 evolved Sea Sparrows remaining. She's virtually defenseless and still out of range of Trinidad Moran. As a relief Eagle arrives and activates her radar, Roosevelt will return to a more passive state in hopes of once again losing her attacker. Unfortunately, the enemy seems to be closing at full speed on her position, and the Trinidad Moran, even though it is staying outside of her gun range, is reporting her position. They may very well be within visual range. It's 22 miles. However, it is daytime, so it is very quite possible that Trinidad Moran has eyeballs on the Roosevelt. Roosevelt will attempt to close the range to the pickup now that the enemy is in pursuit. The Mariscal Sucre appears to be dead, thank goodness, so the eastern flank or escape route may be open if we can conduct the rescue. As we do not yet know the exact location of the refugees, we'll have to send a strike hawk to locate them according to their TACB, or the reasonable facsimile magnetic anomaly detector. The second strike hawk, we're going to rearm and we're going to give it a little bit more range in case we need it. We'll send it on a ferry mission to back up the first strike hawk in case they are unable to locate the target. Now, our orders say that the refugees will be approximately 15 miles from Puerto La Cruz, no more. So we will mark out a location for them, and we'll know that they cannot be outside this approximate radius. We've marked out the approximate search area for the refugees, and we will order the helicopter to fly a search pattern within this area in hopes of picking up the refugees' emergency tactical beacon. We are then ordered to hover over that location for 15 minutes in order to simulate a rescue, retrieval, and we'll add a little time compression. The enemy seems to be trying to close on our position, but if with a little luck, we can still get in and out. Our combat air patrols have returned after rearming and refueling as the Strike Hawk begins her first pass on the search and rescue mission. No luck so far. Not much luck on the second pass. Oh! And we have detected a facility. Unfortunately, this is an enemy facility. Looks like it's some kind of armed unit and not the communications unit we're looking for, so we'll have to be careful and try to avoid that whenever possible, but we still must search for our wayward refugees. So we'll mark this as a AAA unit. And continue the search. The Roosevelt is not within gun range yet, but hopefully if she can get within gun range, she can lay down some naval gunfire on it. Roosevelt is now within gunfire range, and she will lay down a barrage to suppress. Seems as though not much effect, but oh, it does seem as though she has suppressed it or destroyed it, as we're not able to fire any further. And we'll continue the search as the enemy continues to close on us. We may have lost them as they have slowed down a slight bit, and they do not appear to be headed directly for our position. So with a little luck, we may have evaded them and returned to our cloaked status. So our second helicopter is almost ready, and we'll send it in to support the first. The second helicopter is now aloft and in support of the first. Between the two of them, hopefully, we will be able to locate the survivors and get out of this shooting gallery. The enemy is not giving up as more Mirage fighters are detected in the air. And he's moving in on our jammer. We'll deploy two. And more interceptors are detected behind it. Are these Mirage or flank up Mirage? Success. And more bogeys are detected. Oh, looks like some of them are retiring. They may be running for home, but doesn't mean we're going to let them go. Kill them today or kill them tomorrow. The sooner we kill them, the better off. And one more kill, but the others have escaped. A second Strike Hawk has been launched and coordinated her efforts to search the area in support of the first Strike Hawk. As they comb back and forth, seeking those fugitives. The enemy frigates continue to close on our position, even as the helicopters search vainly for the missing evacuees. As the enemy frigates close in, the PC Orions become ready again, and they're called back in to launch a third strike. Hopefully, they can knock out one more of these frigates. However, the frigates will still outclass us because their gun range is longer than ours. The Orions come into range and launch their four missiles at the frigate General Sublette. The enemy is persistent, and more fighters are detected inbound. More Mirage. With plenty of Eagles on hand, their destruction is swift. And even more fighters are detected launching. As the slammers arrive at the General Sublette. A hit! And another! And the Sublette, oh, she defended herself well. She's damaged but not destroyed. The second wave looks like these are rearmed Mirage with more Exocet missiles. Last Eagle arrives and releases her AMRAAM, but it's not enough. Not all the targets are engaged. Five bombers remain and are closing. There just wasn't enough missiles to kill them all. Although out of missiles, the Eagle will remain behind and loiter in order to provide what she can for airborne early warning. It appears as though the enemy has turned back. Could that mean missiles are in the air? The Exocet are sea skimmers and quite stealthy. Vampire, vampire, vampire! And the enemy appears to have fired their missiles, but they are passing behind the Roosevelt. The Roosevelt will keep her radar silent. And they've missed. More vampires are detected, and the Roosevelt will activate now. Evidently, the enemy did not have perfect targeting data and were unable to launch directly on the ship. This has saved us from one missile. Hopefully, it will be sufficient for the rest. And our radar is now active. Once again, the enemy missiles appear to be heading in a direction away from the ship. Will we be outside the detection cone? Well, it's a game of nerves. And yes, they have missed. They are searching past us. They're in a search pattern, in an S search pattern, but they have fired from too far away and their activation point must have been behind the Roosevelt, and they didn't see us. That's about as close as I'd ever like to see. Now that that distraction is over, we will relaunch the Strike Hawk in search of our fugitives. As the helicopters continue to search for the evacuees, Frigate Trinidad Morad moves in on the Roosevelt. And while in gun range, Roosevelt has to engage. Several salvos later, the Moran is sinking. And victory is granted. This concludes Dine and Dash, written for Harpoon 3 and the Player's Database.